I'm Zoltan Neville, part of the architecture faculty here at MOME. So this will be our first lecture of this spring semester. So this lecture series initiative we started last year, and it welcomes prominent Hungarian and international architects, designers, and thinkers to present and discuss their work within the built environment. And we kind of designed this series as a platform for interdisciplinary discussion and exchange between students, professionals within the university, community, and the public to basically open up a forum for academic and general discussion around architecture and the built environment. So we're kicking off this spring with a series titled Architectural Matters, featuring a diversity of lecturers from around Europe whose work focuses on the materialization of forward-thinking concepts. Wide range of expertise creates an opportunity for discussion and reflection on the state of creating our cities of tomorrow. And I am very pleased to have our first invitee here today of the semester, Débora Mesa Molina. She's a European licensed architect and principal of ENSAMBLE Studio, a cross-functional team that she leads with her partner Anton Garcia Abril, based in Madrid and Boston. So balancing imagination and reality, art and science, their work innovates typologies, technologies, and methodologies to address issues as diverse as the construction of the landscape or the prefabrication of the house. And I'd like to thank particularly the Global Voices at MOME for supporting the event, as well as the Cervantes Institute of Budapest. So thank you very much, everyone, for coming. The lecture will be 45 minutes to an hour, followed by time for questions. So please, everyone, write them down. If you don't want to ask in English, feel free to ask in Hungarian, and I or one of your neighbors will translate it. And for anyone who is a licensed architect, this is something new this semester. We are offering the continuing education credit, so the TOVAB Képzés is available for all of our lectures, so feel free to talk to us or write to us to figure out how to get them for attending our lectures. So with this, I'll hand it over to Débora, and thank you everyone for being here.
Well, thank you very much, Zoltan, for the introduction. And thank you for the invitation. It's a pleasure to be here. And to share with you the work that we do in ENSAMBLE Studio, also to get to know the city a bit and the school a bit. I think we had a great discussion this morning also with a group of students, so it's been very nice to get to see a bit of the very early ideas and some of the projects that are being developed and proposed at the school. And I hope that some of the work that I show tonight maybe might resound with some of the topics that we were discussing and hopefully might also inspire, no, or provoke some conversations afterwards. So, in ENSAMBLE Studio, we are we want to say cross-disciplinary team. We like to yes, we're an architecture studio, but we get a lot of inspiration from many other disciplines. Very especially from art and from engineering, from material sciences as well. But of course, then architecture is this incredible practice that that really is enhanced by you know, many other fields of knowledge, you know, humanities and so on. Our work touches different, very different scales, and also is a work that we've been developing in our early stage of our career, very much as local architects in Spain, where after graduating from a polytechnic school and being able to access work through competitions, we felt that we had this amazing opportunity. We had a license to build, but we really didn't know how to build. So our early years, we were very much invested in really understanding how could we build the big ideas, no, that we all have in architecture school. And then when you start to do early projects and competitions, how could we really get to build them? How could we develop the knowledge? How could we learn about materials and not just about the materials that we find in catalogs? But for instance, here, for our first projects that happened in Santiago de Compostela, in a city that has been built with stone historically and where you have to build with stone by code, it was for us really important to understand the whole process of industrial process of transformation of the material from it being a mountain, a piece of landscape, to it being processed until it becomes, no, like a very regular flat tile that we can use in a project. We approached the quarry very naively, you know, really almost walking in, and the fact is that this early visit was fundamental for the development of the project because it became a departure point on how we would approach it. We found, for this project in particular, we found that actually we were not so interested in the very processed materials that were produced, the very perfect pieces of stones. We were interested in the waste material, all the spare material that was kind of useless and also very economic. No, I think for us it was very important that these first projects, they had very low budgets. So we also had to use a lot of our imagination in how to build and do good projects with very little money. No? So in this case, using these very regular stones was, you know, had at the time an important economic agenda behind, no? And as well, of course, an ecological one. The fact is that this, something that maybe sounds very much common sense, especially today, that we need to recycle, no? That we need to reuse materials, that we need to find new opportunities for waste or for elements, spaces that have lost their initial purpose. At the time, it was really difficult to convince, no? Our client, quarry owners, that we would use this waste material. Building a prototype in the quarry and then transporting it to the site in the city center was also very strategic. And it was the first time that we did such a thing, no? Build something twice, but it was key to really reduce the level of uncertainty of working with this material to get everybody comfortable, also for us as a learning tool. And it's definitely something that we started to do in this project very intuitively and that has carried in our own practice, no? How to design not just the building but the construction processes, how to train ourselves by building prototypes, and also how to get others on board to build our own ideas. With this early project that I was partially showing, we also started to develop an interest in construction, because we had the intuition that knowing more about construction, even becoming builders, would give us a lot of freedom. We encountered in many projects the answer of, you know, or the sentence like, this cannot be built. And we wanted to prove sometimes that this was not the case. And this involved us really understanding how things get put together. This is also another very early project, is the Meroscopium House. This is a project that where we are our own clients. That we do because we wanted to learn about how to work with industrialized parts. Here we are using precast concrete, which is an industry that is very advanced in Spain. These parts are used to building civil engineering works, so highways, water channels. And so from an artistic point of view, we were very interested in what would be the spatial, the architectural effect of taking something that's used in a certain context, infrastructures in this case, and bringing it to a domestic space. And at the same time, seeing what spaces it would create, like these very heavy parts. Would we be able to create very light, very transparent spaces with it? And of course, also starting to learn about the benefits of using prefabricated parts or off-the-shelf elements, but not in a very normative way, because we were very aware of some of the problems of prefabrication, that sometimes it's associated with boring repetition, with buildings that all look the same. And so this house was also our excuse to test how we can take very standard parts and assemble them in a non-standard way. I think probably with this house, we used all the fees that we got with the prior project, and this has become also a model of operation in our office. No, I say this because I many times get the question of, okay, how are you able to fund these type of projects? And you will see that there are others that we have done in this way. We are an office that balances very much the projects that we do for others by commissions or competitions, and also research projects like these ones that we do because we need to do them, because we feel that there's a question that we want to ask, or there's an area that we want to explore. And the fact is that works like this one have become seminal for us, have become kind of a spaces of freedom where we've been able to think and create without some of the constraints that you find when you work for others, and that then have really influenced a lot of the work that we've done afterwards. Even today, we keep looking at this house as we are continue to be interested in industrialization and how to scale up. So something that we like very much about this project is that we, in this case, because it's our house in Madrid, we get to use it. No? So it gives you another level of understanding, of experiencing that, with all its mistakes, that it has a lot, because it's a work that we did, again, in a very early moment with very low budget. So it's full of kind of technical mistakes, but also great findings that we did without, at the time, really controlling everything that we were doing. And I think the good thing of doing projects for yourselves or your family, is that sometimes you can take it to the next level. No, you can do things that maybe you would be more cautious to do for somebody else. So this house, you will see how it definitely influences this work, this later work, in a very different context. No, the house is it's a single family house, it's a house built from zero, and here we are in the slaughterhouse in Madrid, another project that talks about reuse, like we were talking this morning. It's a protected historical building that has a very rational structure made with masonry brick in the all the envelope, and inside is a very delicate metallic structure, and that needed to be protected. We were intervening in different warehouses. Two of them were twin houses. And the idea of, the brief was to add quite almost double the surface that the warehouse already has. So we had to increase the amount of square footage. It didn't say how, but it implied in a very immediate response for us, it meant really destroying this kind of basilical type of space that the warehouse had. So our idea was to introduce a new element that would be a new structure and would contain the new space. And they are these bridges that you see here threading through the windows of the old slaughterhouse. Of course, we were lucky that this was designed by engineers, so it was really, it had a very good order. It was also very well built, so we could thread these beams, not just in this warehouse, but in the next one. No? So we were tying together two very similar warehouses. And with this, we were creating this additional space, introducing new activity in it, but preserving the spatial condition of the existing, and also distinguishing the different times, right? We were introducing a new material, concrete, still in a very industrial language, but you could clearly differentiate what was the prior building and what was the new. Why did we choose to also use these prefabricated parts? Was in part to speed up the construction, but mostly to protect the building from excessive construction noise and also the kind of harm that sometimes construction does. So this maneuver that in the video seems like very smooth, it was in fact quite smooth, and it worked very well, but it took us a lot of time to really engineer, and mostly or foremost to convince the heritage people in the city that this would really work. No, but you can see in this project how the way in which the project is built is completely connected with the architecture itself. No, it's this project is a reader's house. It's about bridging knowledge and bridging these two buildings, and the structure in a way is also suggested and designing, and the process of construction is also following this idea. This is the finished building with all of the systems and layers introduced. And in this case, a building for a client after a competition that we won, but that wouldn't have been this same project if we had not built the Meroscopium house and we had not already tested how to use these precast concrete parts, how to design and build with them. So having done that in-house research gave us the knowledge to, and also the power to convince others to develop this project in a very early moment of our career. So our work, especially from the early projects, has touched very different contexts and very different programs and very different scales. This is another of these, like the Meroscopium House, these very seminal important projects that we have done on our own. It's the Truffle House, and in this house we are building also with concrete, but almost in an opposite way. In this case, the experiment we wanted to do was to see how we could, and if we could, create a building in the landscape as if it was landscape itself. So how close could architecture get to the idea of landscape, and also how could we build as much as possible with the local materials around. So for this house, which again, we are almost designing in action, we are using the soil as the formwork, we are using the hay bales from our neighbor, we are using also the concrete from the neighbor plant to fit the spaces in between, no? And in a way, the soil and the hay bales serve as the containers for this structure that we plan. Of course, we plan there's going to be a door and there's going to be a window, but the process, as you can see, it's not a very precise, pristine one. It's almost like a cooking recipe where you more or less have the steps, but if you cook it today or tomorrow, it will taste differently. It will be a different thing, no? And this is something that was very important for us in this project, because as architects, sometimes we want to control too much. And this project is about actually relinquishing control. And in our eyes, it was also about nature taking over. So, you know, defining defining a set of rules, but then not controlling also the evolution of the work, and also not being afraid of the weathering of the building. No, this is a building that it's not that we don't care, it's that we actually want it to change over time. We want the seeds to land, we want the plants to grow, we want it doesn't matter if it gets dirty, it doesn't need to be cleaned and maintained. The cow was also, the neighbor cow was also a collaborator in removing all of the hay from the interior. So in a way, it's this project that creates a story of the local and also takes a lot of risks in making architecture. We had some intuitions of what could happen in the interior and in the exterior, but at some point we also thought, okay, this can be a big failure, no? And it's okay, it will stay in the family, nobody else needs to know. Because, you know, you can see even in the definition of the formwork, these are not like very straight wood planks that are perfectly fit. It's the concrete against the hay bales, is the concrete against the soil, so there are contaminations between the materials. Then we discover there's also incredible textures and that can be read almost as ornamentation that were not precisely designed, no? And this kind of effortless design for us is also super intriguing. How can we get the most architectural, artistic value with the least effort? So when we design these construction processes, it's really not to make things more complicated or for the sake of originality. It's really to also find ways that maybe can deliver architecture more easily sometimes. So this we finished in 2010, so quite some years ago, and it started a topic about materiality, about architecture and nature, about these construction processes that are very hands-on, that try to use also very intensively the materials around, that continues to be in our daily conversations in the office, no? And we keep looking back at this work that you will also see very clearly how it has influenced the work that we have done afterwards. And it's a space that we also use, that we continue to go to and see how it changes, how it it evolves. Again, done at an early stage, so also full of mistakes, things that after the years, after doing other projects, continuing these ideas, we've perfected. But without this work, this one, for instance, the structures of landscaping in Tippett Rice Art Center would not have happened. So here we are in Montana, in the US, in a very very big ranch where our client wanted to do an art center in the middle of the land, the landscape. But they didn't want to do a kind of white box type of museum. They wanted to build a museum very much linked to outdoor sculptural art and to music that would invite people to experience the land and that would also offer some kind of shelter, because it's in this vast land, there's almost no shade, no place to protect yourself from the weather. So the master plan that we did was following the order of constellation, trying to find those meaningful spaces in the land that could be accessed, and developing also almost like an architectural language that was in conversation with the geography of the place. So we were looking at the mountains and the hills and the valleys, the canyons, and we were doing architectures that took those themes and also learned from geological processes of sedimentation, erosion, fragmentation, or this one here, explosion. No? We wanted to create a space that would be built by exploding a mass. So this is the brainstorming part. Obviously, the client saw some of this and was ready to build them, and others was more scared about. But it served to open the conversation, to understand how the site could be used. But thinking about these architectures that were almost like open rooms in the landscape. You don't go to this remote place in Montana to enter a completely air-conditioned building independent of the context. So for the construction process, again, here you find a lot of resonance with how we build the truffle at a different scale. It's not as easy as it seems to shift scale. And especially in this case, it was also very important to adapt to local resources, local labor. But from the project to the real work, we again designed this construction process on how everything would come together, how the ground would serve also as the formwork that would help to build in one of these, the bigger structure. In this case, we were casting the pieces flat and then tilting them, so each piece had its own logic and its own scale, also based on the context. The idea was that they would, as I mentioned earlier, they would serve as a shelter for visitors, shelter from the rain, from the wind, but also as a spaces for performing in nature. So with this project, we continue to investigate, no, this idea of an architecture that can be understood as part of the landscape, that can be also understood as a piece of art in this context, but that has the most basic functions that architecture has, no, of mediating between the scale of the territory and the scale of the human being, of providing shelter against the elements, in this case also providing kind of an acoustic surface that has a very specific function. But again, in this context, understanding an idea about order, about maybe perfection, even about aesthetics, that it's doesn't come so much from what we've learned in architecture school and from architecture history, starts to break some of the rules, like abstract expressionism, no, did in art, and starts to create new ones, in this case by looking more at the context, at nature, at landscape, and creating works that that resound with those. This work is very difficult to show in video, so you have to go visit. I'm sorry. Also, in this case, the client was key. Now, this is the type of projects that we, you know, where we enjoyed full freedom, but not doing it in-house, but with a client that was really supportive. Both of the of our clients, they are artists, so I think they understand the importance of creative freedom. So still in the US, while we were doing this work in Montana, because of that work in Montana, we decided to do the move to the US. And we also started to research and teach at MIT in the university with the ambition of connecting practice and research with education. We wanted to, of course, we loved researching in-house, but we also wanted to learn what it was to research within a bigger institution and potentially have more impact in the world. So we started to think about continued thinking about prefabrication in the lab, but working with super light materials, in this case, foams. No, we knew already what it was to build with precast concrete, which is very heavy, and this has limitations. And we started to, you know, emulating at first some of the logics of precast concrete, but substitute the concrete for much lighter materials, no, that we could lift with a car jack and move with a book trolley, and figuring it out so that we could build it ourselves with not very complicated resources. So this is within a laboratory, so it's very experimental. This you wouldn't be able to build in real life because foam is very flammable. It doesn't resist impact well. Also, at the time we were trying to connect with the industries to recycle the foam, but we couldn't really take that much further. But we are very practical, we are very pragmatic, and immediately we wanted to test out in real life this idea of light prefabrication. And we needed a home in the US, so we went to a neighborhood, Brookline, that has some of the best public schools for our kids, but we looked in a kind of a real estate app called Zillow. I'm sure there's the equivalent here. We looked for the cheapest property No? And that kind of garage structure appeared. And we decided to apply, you know, this, this research of light prefabrication for different reasons. First, we wanted to build in Madrid because we couldn't afford to have the house built in the US. And then we didn't want to spend money in foundations. So it had to be very light so that the existing concrete block building would resist the addition of the house. This is our team, architects, not builders, building the house as if it was almost like a model. But again, because it's very lightweight, it's much easier to handle. And here you can see my partner Anton and my partner Javier here as well. So the constraints of this house, it had to fit into a shipping container. We were lucky that the plot was 30 by 40 almost, and the maximum length that you can that can travel in a container is 40 feet. So we were able to maximize the kind of volume. In this case, of course, you can see also references to the Meroscopium house in these big parts that simplify a lot the assembly process. But in this case, the advancement was that these components already embed some of the mechanical systems, the insulation, some of the storage spaces are embedded. So they start to be much more complex parts that arrive to the site. And because we didn't have really space to stock, we had to very well synchronize all the maneuver to have the house delivered and assembled. No? For this in an already built neighborhood, you can imagine, you know, the neighbors, I mean, some were a bit concerned about the look of the house, but they were all very happy about the, you know, the speed at which the construction happened, creating all, I mean, creating no waste and no, no noise, no? And also in this house, because the garage was a more compartmented space, we wanted to do like a multifunctional domestic space, no? Where we could work and we could live, we could cook, we could do different functions during the day. In that sense, typologically very different from other, from the Meroscopium house, for instance, where the functions are very well delimited. And when we did this house, immediately we were thinking how this could be applied at a larger scale. How could we build multifamily housing that was much cheaper, much nicer, and with, you know, more up-to-date technologies? In the U.S., in most of the big cities, there's a huge housing crisis, as it happens in many other cities around the world. And so this is a big issue that we are concerned with. When we built the previous house, the Cyclopean, we rented a warehouse. And here we were realizing that our office was shifting in a way where prototyping, building was really important. At this point, it was not only prototyping, but really fabricating buildings. So here we started to build our own office, also using the building to test some larger scale prefab structures. But then within it, we are now very actively developing architecture as a product. Architecture, in this case, for housing projects where we don't build by layers, no? The structure, mechanical systems, the insulation, the finish, but we build walls, we build slabs, we build the kitchen bathroom pods. They each are complete in themselves. And then, let's say, the key is how they are put together. We are especially interested in larger scale projects because there are already a lot of products that work at the small scale of the single family house or even up to 3-4 levels. But we are very interested in this case, this system that we are developing that will work for high rise. So where we combine these prefabricated parts with a concrete structure on the site. And this allows us to build, with the limit that concrete structures have, but making all the process very efficient and also being able to measure very well the ecological footprint of the different parts. Actually, what you're seeing on the screen is like a early version. Now, when looking more closely at the carbon emissions of the different materials that we use, we're starting to build to shift the technology to using more of CLT and timber products. So this is in constant development right now, but the ambition, the idea is to be able to build buildings at a bigger scale. In this big factory space that I was showing that it's our office now, we continue to, of course, we're very inspired. We continue to work on this idea of industrialized construction. But we also continue our research on landscape. And right now we are working on a project in South Korea that's to build a visitor center of a garden of gardens. And so, continuing the work that we've been doing on creating buildings that learn from how landscape operates and how landscape is inhabited, we are we designed this building. I mean, I don't know if you've noticed, but all of our design process starts with models. We love to make, we love to think with our hands. And in this case, we are prototyping. This is a 2,000 square meter building. We are prototyping, we are designing the construction process and prototyping how we are going to create this shape. The idea is to create a formwork that we can recycle later so that we don't waste a lot of material and also that we can, that we don't need a lot of very high-tech, very complex systems or equipment to build it. So here we're building with, in this case, with carbon with glass fibers and resin, we're building this formwork. It's a technology that's used to build boats so that we can design the form. This is a very small piece. And we are also, with this prototype, showing how we can build it in our factory, dismantle it, and take it somewhere else. In this case, we use this for an exhibition in Versailles, an art and landscape exhibition this summer, that our client also sponsored. And we used it to test all of the process and the maneuver of transportation, of reassembly. We are right now in the process of, we finished the construction documents, so we are in the process of discussing and trying to find a construction company in South Korea. You can imagine that this is a difficult conversation for the client when there's not a reference. And so with this type of works, we want to make sure that we got it right, but we also want to help those discussions with contractors so that they see how it can be done, no? And then this cannot be done, it's eliminated from the equation. This is a walk through the project that has some outdoor areas, has water, has vegetation. So you can see again how this continues the work that we did in tipped rise with the structures of landscape. But in this case, it's a building that has a more elaborate program. And so this, you know, by developing this formwork and wanting to recycle it, this is how we are now thinking that we're going to recycle the formwork in all the underground excavated event spaces. We want to create this skin that that provides light and an atmosphere. This is the state of the site 6 months ago, so now it's much more developed. And hopefully we will start construction within a few months. So I will finish the talk with this project, which is once more a project that we really had the need to do. It's another very good example on reuse, so, and very different from other projects. It also connects with the first video I was showing of the quarry. This is a quarry, an abandoned quarry in the island of Menorca, in the Mediterranean Sea. The stone is very porous, and there are, in this island, there are a lot of prehistoric monuments, funerary monuments, that they excavated the ground to bury the bodies, to more contemporary quarries where the material that's local has been exploited in many different ways. Many of the houses in this island, they excavate the basement, and with that stone, they build the house. So we found, accidentally, when we visited this island, we found this quarry that was being sold as rural land without giving much credit to the space itself. But we were blown away when we saw this space and the potential it had. So we decided to make it a project because it addressed a topic that we are very much interested in, which has to do with the kind of life of these industrial spaces, and how do you take something that's valuable and you revive it. And basically the project, which is still ongoing, it will take quite some time. It's about understanding the place and building with its logics. So in this case, the main architectural gesture is to introduce light and air in the dark corners where there is none, so that it can become architecture. Otherwise, it's an industrial abandoned site. And by doing that, the whole kind of thermodynamics of the place change. Suddenly, we have cross ventilation, we have natural light. And we have a space that can be inhabited. And then there's a tremendous work of cleaning, of just doing accommodating, reading the space. No, I think the architecture is already there. It's just about interpretation, about how to do the minimal, so that. We can live in it, but live in it in a very different way, like we are used to living in conventional buildings, no, that we dominate. No, we can control the temperature to the last degree. We decide, you know, how everything works, and if it doesn't work, we fix it. This is a wild place in a way that forces us to understand it first, and then, you know, work with very basic elements, no, air, light, water, fire, to try to make it a bit more comfortable, not just enough to be able to be inhabited. But we live there as nomads, no? It's very different to be in the winter than to be in the spring. And so it has become kind of a lab where, as we are building the work, we are also learning, you know, how we can build in greater harmony with nature. So it's an experiment in all senses that it's shifting very much our sensibility, and we feel like after 20 years of practice, we are almost like returning to architecture school with this work, and hopefully we'll have also a great influence in the work that comes next. But for now, it's still very much ongoing and emerging. Thank you very much, and I'm very ready for your questions.
Thank you very much, Deborah. It's really inspiring. Can I open to questions? Anyone in the audience? Oh yeah, some lights maybe. So maybe I'll start with a question to get things going. Actually, it's kind of frustrating because every question I had, you answered it with the next project, so then I had to come up with it.
That's a good thing.
But the narrative is good. So actually, I have maybe one. Seeing the Korean project here at the end and all your different workflow, so it's very clear this kind of manual process going through and discovering things. And I'm curious, I mean, for now and maybe throughout the last 20 years, how do you manage this like manual, especially scaling up the manual and to digital dialogue somehow, to be able to do that experimentally and then replicate it in a way to scale up and kind of control with this, you know, I guess there's a controlled randomness somehow, but yeah, still some control. So maybe can you talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, so I'm showing here mostly the creative process, like how the project starts and then the construction of it and the experience of it. But of course, we use a lot of digital tools that are fundamental, especially to facilitate the design and the execution. Examples: in this project of the quarry, I passed through it, but I was talking about something else, so I didn't mention it. But maybe we can go back a bit. For the first step in this one, which is a project that it's already built, was to 3D scan the space. No, and actually, this is a 3D scan of the place. No? All of this. That's a 3D scan, which is amazing. No. Some years ago, we would have been like with a measuring tape, it would have been a nightmare. And now you go there, you spend 6 hours, maybe full day in this case. You put the scan, you put the references, and you get an incredible, not just an incredible 3D model, but, you know, the sections of this space, like this section, I think we couldn't have done it better and more, you know, to do more justice to the space. These are cuts from the 3D scan, no? So again, this effortless way of designing. If the building is there and you just want to have it well documented, what are the tools that will serve us best, right? We don't need to do a, you know, model make everything. No, we do, you know, we do a 3D scan, and this then in this case, really, there's not much digital design to do after because it's very hands-on, this quarry in this case. But for instance, if we wanted to do in the future, imagine, we don't want to use glass, but if we wanted to do glass windows and we have a very regular profile, there's nothing better than 3D scan it, and then you have the real dimensions and the full form of the window of the element. So in this case, we used it in this way. In a lot of the prefab work that we're doing, we're working in Revit. Yeah. You know, we use all the digital tools to do the project, and also the factory that you have seen, it's a very manual one, but right now we are working in, once the product is developed, we are working in automating a factory and using automation to build, because if you're going to replicate the same element on and on and on, it doesn't make sense, precisely because we have built it with our hands and we know the pain it is to screw 1,000 screws. And nobody wants to do it, not an architecture student, but not an architect or a builder. No? Nobody wants to do that physical work. No? So the next step is to automate those parts of the work that you know, are very burdensome for people. So we think about the digital in various ways, but always thinking how it will facilitate the work and how can we save time for what's most important.
Mm-hmm. Anyone else? Yes.
Here. How did you get so familiar with three guys?
For everyone.
After your studies, how did you get so familiar with these special sort of, is it on? Yeah, okay. So how did you get so familiar with these materials? For example, you said that was the first time you've used these precast concrete elements, and after that the concrete structure, that was also your first time, and you also said you didn't know whether if it's gonna stand or if it's going to work, but you must have had some sense of its success. So how did you get the experience to use them so confidently?
So by being curious and by going to the factory sites. So when we, in the first projects, when we wanted to build with stone, we could have taken a catalog. Okay, this, that, no? But we were very curious to see how the material was produced. Also in Galicia, you get megalithic architectures in the landscape, all the castros, abandoned castles made with stone. You get incredible works of architecture from very different times, medieval times, more contemporary times, built with stone, no? And you have the reference of how can you build with stone. And then you see very sad contemporary buildings that for us, it was not really using the potential that that stone had. So this was, we said, okay, let's go to the quarry. Let's learn because, you know, first there's the acceptance that you know very little. And so you need to learn from those who know. And so I don't know why this is, it's like, so that's the first step for us, like really going to visit sites and getting to learn, seeing how things are produced. You cannot imagine, unless you've done it, how much you learn from that, from just visiting a factory that fabricates bricks. If you do it yourself, then, I mean, the learning is exponential. And so that we have always liked to expose ourselves to that, to learn with precast concrete. There are, I said, no, in Spain there's a very good industry, so we see these buildings built and these infrastructures built. There's a history of great architects also in Spain that have built with concrete and precast concrete, like Miguel Fisac, for instance. He did the beautiful projects. So, you know, we have this history, we have the industry, and then we go there and we see it. And once you do, if you go and you visit and you see it, you learn up to a certain point. If you build a building using the technology, you learn so much more. No? So it's little steps, but the learning is really easy. No? It's, everything is super easy in reality. Really, building is super easy. You know, like, I don't know, even doing electricity circuit, it's pretty easy. You only have to do it. And once you do it, you learn it. Of course, we cannot be experts in everything, so, you know, we specialize. And but I think for architects, the making part is fundamental, because once you've built and you know the logics of building, you never design the same way.
Thank you.
Anyone else?
Hi. So my question is that why did you decide to invest into prefabrication in this level? So much. I'm talking about this building a factory and everything else, because you know, for me prefabrication is cool, of course, but it kind of seems like an over-industrialized thing. So there is so many participants, and why did you decide that you have to step into this market? What benefit does it to you? I mean, as a studio, of course.
Well, we've arrived to seeing a lot of or having a lot of interest in industrialization through doing some of our early projects, that in that case we were just, you know, trying to see how it worked, what it could deliver, how it could serve architecture. For us, it's no difference in the sense, like, the choice of doing a building off-site or on-site, it's based on the circumstances. It's not, you know, we don't make those decisions without a real reason behind, no? So the, you know, the benefits of off-site construction are multiple, especially in certain contexts, urban contexts, especially once you start to get deep into the idea of, you know, the ecological footprint of buildings and construction, and how construction industry is one of the industries that contaminates the most. And so when you start to think how you can make these processes cleaner, more efficient, more controlled, it's clearly a very interesting, very, we feel, very important path to pursue. Not that it's going to solve every problem and every building. I think some buildings it makes sense that they are industrialized, and other buildings it doesn't make sense that they are industrialized. For us, again, we've done some buildings trying industrialization. We have studied very much how residential buildings specifically are built, and the buildings may seem different, and I'm talking mostly about like multifamily developments, but they are all pretty much the same.
So it's kind of an architectural freedom for you, you know.
For us, it's a way that we want to explore on how we can make much better buildings, much cleaner buildings, and construction processes that are more affordable for wider range of the population. When we did our house in Brookline, you know, that's a neighborhood that we could only afford to buy that building because it was the ugly duckling of the neighborhood, and it was a kind of residual site, and it was a bit out of code. So we had to work very intensively with the city to put it back for code, and then we decided to develop. But really for, I'm not talking a low-income family, for a middle-class family to afford a house in that neighborhood, it's really impossible, no? And I think this is a problem that we are seeing where it's, you know, houses are becoming much more expensive. The cost doesn't mean that the quality is better. The way in which buildings are built, reinventing the wheel constantly to actually deliver the same type of spaces and typologies, it's a lot of wasted effort. No? So what we're trying to see is if we can standardize the parts that accept repetition without ending up doing two buildings the same, right? So I think that the value is in how things are organized, in, of course, the envelope is very important because that speaks about also climate, and that has great levels of customization as well. So we are looking for where a bathroom. I mean, if you are building a multifamily housing, you don't need the neighbor's bathroom to be maybe different. You can design a super good bathroom that serves everybody, that is accessible, that and it doesn't matter if your neighbor has the same bathroom, no? Or the kitchen mechanical systems, or there are things that, or the slab. Do you really mind if the sequence of slabs that makes your roof is similar to your neighbor or to the other building? If it's, imagine that they tell you that it's, you know, it's a slab that engineers and architects have been designing and thinking carefully for years, no? That single slab. No, I would buy that. Like, why do we buy a car? And we customize some things, but others we accept that our neighbors has the same, and actually we have the assurance that it has passed, you know, safety controls, quality controls. If you need to fix the engine, you actually know where the engine is, no? If you open a wall, like this wall, probably nobody knows what you will find behind it, no? Because in architecture, we build, you know, in a very old-fashioned way, right? Nobody follows an architectural plan, by the way, in most of the cases, no? Especially when it has to do with everything that is hidden, which is the most important part. We care about the painting that's perfect, you know, and that decoration there, and if we like the facade style or not, but nobody buys a house and asks, okay, where are my ducts? If I need to fix or change or put more outlets, how do I do it? How much energy does the air conditioning system consume? And so, you know, we are just interested in doing that because we also think it's very important from a climate perspective. And we also think that, luckily, younger generations are much more interested in that. And we all in general, no? We're more interested in how much energy we consume, how, you know, the materials that build our buildings, how have they arrived to where they are, and this is going to become a must very soon. So we are interested in it. Maybe we don't get to build many buildings with the system, or we do. We don't know.
Well, good luck.
Thank you.
I will tell you next time.
So, as I can see, you have like two really different directions of how you build, like a really controlled one, and like when you're trying to find places that you just use as the last one, what you just showed us, and it seems that they are like against each other. My question is that what do you think, what is the point what both of these directions share in your way of thinking and making architecture?
So, I mean, I would disagree with what you said about that some buildings start to be used and some not.
Used?
Did I hear something like that?
I meant you have two ways of making buildings, like a really controlled one, and like where you just natural of the creating part of the building. So yeah.
Yeah. So I mean, they're just like different questions that we are asking with each project. Like some projects are more connected with with the landscape, let's say, or with the natural environment, and they respond more directly to that. Others, and yes, in that case, it's about how much do you control, but then thinking about, you know, buildings that can age and can erode and can maybe disappear in the future, I don't know. So we are very, very interested in this, in learning from nature and learning from landscape and also working with very local materials. And we've done projects with that, but there are projects where it makes sense for these projects to happen. And then we've done projects that sometimes use the same materials, no? Because, for instance, when we've used concrete, we've used concrete that we blend with stone and with earth, and it becomes something very amorphous. And we've done projects where, you know, concrete is prefabricated and it's in a fixed form, no? And there we are, you know, we are just looking at a different set of circumstances. Now, sometimes we are trying to, in the case of the reader's house, that which is a historic building, we are trying to see how we can make the least impact also with construction in a building that it's protected, so it makes sense that we use off-site construction. In the case of you know, of the house, the Meroscopium, we very specifically want to use precast concrete technology. That's already a product that we are using, so you have to understand that technology and you have to work with its rules. No, you cannot maybe create something very amorphous when you have formally very strict, no, parts. So sometimes we are very, the work is very much informed by the technology that we are using and the construction process that that follows. And maybe in the latest project that I showed, there's which is this or the one before this museum in South Korea, we are starting to you know, use different methods of construction. No, there's something that's going to happen on site because it makes more sense that it happens locally on site, and we will adjust to the tools and know-how there. And there's a part which is the formwork that we want to prefabricate and ship there. No? So I think these are not completely separate parts. And we are also very interested in the idea of, can you industrialize a landscape? Like, that question makes me super excited. And I don't know yet, like we have not arrived there, but it's not something that we discard for sure. No? Only that, yeah, we've started these paths for projects that had very different conditions, and we have continued to do projects based on the context, what made sense.
Thank you.
I get this question a lot. It's very hard. Like, why don't you mix? But I don't know. I don't have a good answer for it.
Mm-hmm.
Anyone else? Maybe one more question? One last one? Someone? No? Okay. Maybe I have to finish. Maybe do you have, so I feel like you, with Anton, you guys have kind of built your own path, I mean, directly from school to slowly create the narrative of what you're interested in. Do you have any advice for students who are finishing or you know, the new generation of architects, how to approach that and find their path in this kind of entrepreneurial way, or like self-activated way somehow?
I don't know if I can advise, but I mean, I have a lot of sometimes the students will ask, you know, like, what do I do when I go out of a school? And the fact is that I always think that I think the new generations or the younger generations have more sensibility, and this sensibility will make them more prepared. I mean, more sensibility towards, I think, the big issues that you know, we all have to face as an architects. We do, like climate, for instance, or housing crisis, or this type of or social inequality. And I feel that you know, I think that you guys have to try to find the freedom to pursue your own sensibility and develop, you know, those topics that you're interested in. Because I think we all perform better doing the things that we love. And so I think architecture school is a great place to start to find what you like. And of course, when you go out and you start to work also, but I think it's very important to listen to yourself and start to detect where do you, which projects suddenly excite you more, no? What are your, and try to put yourself in those situations. You know, we have managed to find those spaces for freedom, and we don't have rich families. We have been super poor architects, and we continue to be kind of not so wealthy because, you know, the fees that we got from a project, we saved super old school also. We are not like investors in anything. We just like save. And when the bag is full, we said, okay, let's do the truffle house. No? And I have to say that by being builders, also fees are higher when you build stuff for somebody else. So I think that if you know how to build stuff on top of designing, you can also get additional fee by building. So for instance, in the project of the first project that I showed, we became the contractors because nobody wanted to take the liability of building that stone wall, no? So we said, okay, we'll do it. And the fee was very good, and we built a Meroscopian house. So I think you can find ways. You don't need to be, you know, to have a magic ball or to have a lot of money to really make space for the things that you want to try. Find the very important, the allies, because architecture by yourself, this is very hard, this is very difficult. But yeah, I think that there's architects are very much needed. Good architecture is very much needed. And I think that by finding those areas of the discipline that you are more interested in and trying to work in those, you will be happier and serve the profession much better.
Okay, thank you very much for the time. Thank you everyone for coming. And the next lecture will be the 14th of March, I think. So I hope to see some of you again. And I think hopefully there's still some drinks or something in the back, and we can slowly consume everything before leaving. So thanks everyone for coming. And thank you very much for Débora for having us.
Thank you.